Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank Matthew for that very exciting introduction. Made me sound like I was doing some really important stuff. I appreciate it. And I really want to thank Julian and Melanie Reese. Julian, and where's Melanie? Melanie Reese, just a wonderful couple. Thank you so much for the invitation and for your warm hospitality. I'd like to thank the staff and friends, fellows, students of InterVarsity for your gracious and kind welcome. It's a real privilege to be here. I want to speak for a few minutes on the subject, Moral Mondays and the Meaning of Justice in America. When I first wrote my book, Between Sundays, Black Women and Everyday Struggles of Faith, as an ethnography detailing the ways in which African-American women in rural North Carolina live out their faith on a daily basis beyond the pristine walls of Sunday morning church services, I never imagined that I would, over a decade later, return to North Carolina and document this kind of everyday engagement through a social movement called Moral Mondays. In the late 1990s, I had spent more than a year writing and documenting the ways in which women's faith compelled them to get involved in various issues in their communities, from protesting industrialized hog farming, to school integration efforts, to accessing running water for rural residents. In addition, faith seemed to help mediate the more personal decisions they made around issues like tithing and sexuality. I argued then that the emphasis purely on race, class, and gender markers of identity to the exclusion of spirituality failed to capture the importance of one's faith in the way one lives out one's daily life. When I returned to the state and learned of the Moral Monday campaigns this past summer, I was immediately interested in what the campaign might mean for thinking about the role of faith in public life. The intent of the movement, led by the Reverend Dr. Willie Barber, president of the North Carolina State NAACP and a local pastor, was to draw attention to the ways in which the newly elected Republican leadership in the state, holding both the governorship and majorities in the House and the Senate, how the Republican leadership had come to create laws limiting, as they define them, voting rights, cutting social programs, decreasing education expenditures, amending tax law to give more significant breaks to the wealthy, and attempting to roll back environmental protections. The campaign consisted of organized sit-ins at the State House every Monday for the duration of the legislative session, with over 2,500 people participating weekly, engaged in civil disobedience, and over 850 of them arrested. The issues, as compelling as they were not the sole impetus for my interest. Instead, it was the very framing of the activity as a Moral Monday, a move that had the linguistic effect of reappropriating a term traditionally identified with more conservative causes. It was that naming that raised my spiritual and intellectual antennas. In fact, the very naming of the action as moral seemed to reposition the boundaries of moral action. For so long, moral had come to mean something entirely different than concerns about education, voting rights, mass incarceration, the environment, and the like. These issues were the issues of justice, not morality. And if for no other reason, the political coalescence of the religious right in the 1980s and 1990s seemed to solidify, at least in the public imagination, the seeming innate relationship between morality and concerns around sex, abortion, and same-sex relationships. Jerry Falwell's provocatively entitled Moral Majority seemed to say it all. while suggesting that not only were these personal piety issues moral, they reflected the understanding and aims of the majority of Americans. And they were the new political issues around which evangelicals should align. In these few minutes, I'd like to talk a bit about what we might learn from Moral Mondays about the crisis of faith and justice in our society, and finish with a bit of my own explanation of my spiritual development on these issues as a Christian and an anthropologist. The NAACP's campaign, though written in the media as a political critique of the government, was much more than that. The campaign, bookended by sermons, gospel songs, and biblical lessons on faith, hope, and justice, identified not only a political and legislative crisis in the state, but it also marked something of a major spiritual crisis. The critiques of the legislature and the governor, as piercing as they were, compared little in relationship to the implicit critique of the church and its witness in the world. On trial in North Carolina were not simply the governor and his compatriots, but the very religion of those who sat in church pews Sunday after Sunday and those who preach in its pulpits. For too long, the campaign seemed to suggest the body of Christ had limited morality to mere concerns about personal piety and family values without taking into consideration the full weight of the biblical text. In fact, in one of Barber's most piercing critiques and explications of the term moral, he suggested that conservative Christians were not conservative at all, but rather liberal in their selective reading of the Bible, omitting the Bible's mandates about caring for the poor, seeking justice, and looking out for the least of these, our brothers. True biblical conservatives, he asserted, with his seeming photographic recall of biblical texts, should aim to, quote, conserve the Bible in its entirety. Barber's reading of the text and appropriation of the moral mandate to take up issues of justice seems an emerging and sustained critique of contemporary evangelicalism and its political witness in the world. The Pope himself weighed in on this public dilemma just weeks ago on the heels of entrenched ideological standoffs on the right and the left, and an economic crisis that has sent many into unemployment and poverty while significantly increasing the wealth gap worldwide. The Pope, ever sympathetic to the cry of the poor, uttered these words: "We cannot insist only on issues related to abortion, gay marriage, and the use of contraceptive methods. This is not possible. The dogmatic and moral teachings of the church are not all equivalent. The church's pastoral ministry cannot be obsessed with the transmission of a disjointed multitude of doctrines to be imposed insistently. We have to find a new balance. Otherwise, even the moral edifice of the church is likely to fall like a house of cards, losing the freshness and fragrance of the gospel. The proposal of the gospel must be simple, profound, radiant. It is from this proposition that the moral consequences then flow." The Pope's hefty words seem to point out not only the political stakes at hand, but also the spiritual stakes, the damage done to the gospel itself by the ways in which the church's involvement in social concerns has been narrowly defined. Quote, "The freshness and fragrance of the gospel, he worries, will be lost if the church doesn't open its heart to the concerns of the poor and narrate a gospel that brings more than rigid personal mandates. It is, after all, out of the love of the gospel, the moral consequences flow." And yet it is that freshness of the gospel that many would accuse liberals of forgetting, the saving, atoning work of Christ on behalf of sinners, a word we hardly feel comfortable using in our most cosmopolitan environments. And yet that gift of grace is what transforms us. Barber's Moral Mondays and the Pope's call to a more holistic gospel both seem to harken back to a time when the language was different and the engagement more profound. Not wrapped in neoliberal commitments to individualism, capital accumulation, and American exceptionalism, Evangelicals at one time believed the gospel could cost all. It was a sacrificial commitment, not guaranteeing purely middle class and family comfort. For Catholics, many point to the impetus of the Vatican II and the liberation struggles on behalf of the poor in Latin America, a moment which saw a dramatic rise in Catholic social work and evangelization. While for evangelicals, many point to a time when believing the gospel meant being willing to put one's life and limb on the line for racial justice. The history of America's long abolitionist struggle is the hallmark of evangelical social action. Committed to the cause of freedom and justice, believing that the care of the least of these was the mandate of God, evangelicals actively participated in the Underground Railroad, ushering countless enslaved persons to freedom and campaigning religiously across the country in anti-slavery rallies. It was evangelical missionaries from the North who founded many of the historically black colleges and universities in the South. My own alma mater, Spelman College, founded by missionaries in 1881 to educate black women in Georgia, a mission some thought impossible, others thought useless. Today, Spelman graduates one of the highest number of African-American women who go on to earn PhDs, I would be in that number, the highest number of black medical doctors, the second highest number of black medical doctors, second only to Xavier University, and the largest number of black women who go on to earn PhDs in the STEM fields, science, technology, engineering, and math. Evangelical faith, Jesus-loving faith, had a heyday when it came to dramatic, transformative social change. The abolitionist movement, with its strong evangelical leadership, reflects a high moment in evangelical Protestantism, while the civil rights movement represents the ongoing presence of black Christianity in the work of liberation. While the Southern strategy and the alignment of Southern Christians with segregationist efforts in the South forever changed the direction and spirit of this earlier campaign, the foundation for justice had been laid and does not need to be lost. There are two histories from which we can choose to move forward, and it is of these histories that Barber and the Pope evoke. As an anthropologist and an African American and a Christian, the journey to appreciating these seeming tensions has been embedded in the very development of my faith walk. Raised in the Progressive Baptist Church, an African-American denomination founded by Martin Luther King Jr. and his father, Daddy King, along with Gardner C. Taylor and Wyatt T. Walker, in the height of the Civil Rights Movement in 1961, I understand the early importance of faith and commitments to social justice. The Progressive Baptist Convention, after all, was founded in response to the National Baptist Convention, the nation's largest Baptist denomination. It was founded in response to the National Baptist Convention's refusal to engage in the civil rights movement. As the movie The Butler, for those of you who've seen it, so clearly describes, not all African Americans were vested in the process of civil disobedience. There was a school of gradualism that prevailed upon many, whereby many believed that society would change gradually as the hearts and minds of individuals changed with the knowledge of the gospel. It was the same school of gradualism that defined Billy Graham's long evangelical ministry. The Progressive Baptist Convention was formed in response to that sentiment. Not only was my faith informed by my Progressive Baptist roots, in grade school I had a best friend who was Pentecostal, a member of the PAW, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. And she would tell me rather clearly that if I wasn't saved with the evidence of speaking in tongues, I was going to hell. She didn't care how good or nice a person I was. I needed Jesus and the infilling of the Holy Ghost by the evidence of tongues. As her worry for my soul's salvation eventually became my own worry, I went to college and was discipled in a campus ministry whose emphasis was upon evangelism. The passion of the scriptures and the heart for Jesus' admonition to go into the world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, became real to me. After college, I had two options, missionary work or graduate school in anthropology. Both had been deemed handmaidens of colonialism, and yet I chose anthropology, and my faith has been the richer for it. With anthropology came a clearer understanding of my faith and the ways in which culture acts upon faith and shapes it in the most ubiquitous ways. I am not dejected by the church or religion when things don't go right, because I understand that it is man's human attempt to interpret the teachings of God in a social realm that is under construction. We animate our faith, informed as we are, by our own social positioning, by our race, class, gendered, nationalist orientations. At the same time, I'm ever more clear of this truth, that God calls us to live lives of righteousness and justice. We don't get to choose. Liberals can't focus on justice to the exclusion of righteousness, and conservatives can't focus on righteousness to the exclusion of justice. God's word is demanding. It lifts us above ourselves, our own human capacities. In Psalms 89:14, the psalmist writes these words, "The foundations of your throne, O God, are righteousness and justice." I've always been struck by that passage because it seems that the two, righteousness and justice, are forever entangled in mutual conditions of dependency. Indeed, scholars suggest that the two words here are almost interchangeable. In other words, it's nearly impossible to have one without the other. One scholar opined that only in our Western world, where we establish dualities of public and private, do we try to most fervently create a distinction between personal righteousness and social or public justice. Yet the scriptures do not make contrasting distinctions. Translated, if we think we're righteous and yet tolerate injustice, we may just be like the Pharisees whom Jesus tried as whitewashed tombstones. And likewise, if we fancy ourselves champions of justice and yet forsake the call of righteousness God has on all of our lives, we make a mockery of Christ and his atoning and transforming power. Indeed, in a number of accounts, the scriptures tend to link the concepts of righteousness and justice. On numerous occasions, we find the ideas expressed jointly. Psalms 103:6 says, "The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed." Psalms 33:5 says, "God loves righteousness and justice." Isaiah 5:16 says, "The Lord of hosts is exalted in justice, and the holy God shows himself holy in righteousness." And Psalms 99:4 says, you have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob." And watch what Jesus himself says in the New Testament. "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin. In other words, you give a tenth of your income. You do what's right, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former," Matthew 23:23. Jesus wants us to hold the two in tension. There is much to be made right in the world. What would it look like if we collectively, as a nation, revisited the history of the prison industrial complex, an institution that has decimated Black and brown communities across the country for decades? Michelle Alexander writes in her revolutionary work, The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in an Age of Color Blindness, that between 1980 and 1990, the number of people in prisons and jails soared from roughly 300,000 to more than 2 million. By 2007, the number was closer to 7 million Americans, the vast majority of them Black and brown. What might it look like if we all revisited the ways in which our economy has shifted from what some might deem a more responsible 20th century capitalism to what scholars now call a period of late capitalism or even neoliberalism, where so many relationships, even our most intimate, altruistic, and spiritual ones, are enmeshed in economies of monetary exchange. We live in a nation today where the richest 1% of households owns 37% of all wealth. In 2009, a report by Thomas Shapiro, scholar at Brandeis University, reports that a representative survey of American households revealed that the median wealth of white families was $113,149, compared with $6,325 for Latino families and $5,677 for black families. Wealth inequality exists. What would it look like if we revisited the histories of women in this country and around the globe and tried to make a lasting impact on various forms of gender discrimination and oppression? God calls Christians to accept the saving grace of Christ, not as a license to live comfortably, but as a mandate to live boldly the ideals of righteousness and justice. Thank you.
I too would like to thank Julian and all the other folks at Veritas for inviting me. I feel honored to be here, very lucky to be on the same stage with Dr. Frederick. See a lot of people I know out there, a lot of people I don't know. This is supposed to be freewheeling and unscripted, so, and for better or worse, I do not have a script. So looking forward to the conversation. But let me just say a couple of things. My students have heard me say this many times and won't be surprised, but I often say that theologies, religious languages, ways of being religious in the world are like languages, and you can tell lies in any language. I can say the same thing in Spanish and English. I can say some things with my voice in Spanish or English or with body language. It often doesn't matter what language I pick. Sometimes it could. Sometimes there's distinctive things you can only say in one language. But mainly you can say most of the things you want to say in any language. And that's not the important thing. The important thing is whether you're telling the truth. Because you can tell lies in any language. And you can tell the truth and be ignorant at the same time. Very insensitive, very unconstructive. So what we want to do is use the language which is Christianity. Like, faith was on the flyer. And that's not just propositions of doctrine. It's what scholars often call praxis, practice. So it's what you do and what you think. What you do by not saying something, or what you do when you keep your mouth shut and just do it, right? All these kinds of things packed together can be like a language. And what we want to do is say true and useful things. I'm especially interested as a scholar in whether we can use Christian languages in 20th century American cultural history to say true and useful things about making the world better on fronts of social justice. And sometimes that means I'm critiquing people that I think are telling lies or not doing constructive things. It's not necessarily the case that most Christians, most of the time, do say true and useful things with their language and praxis. But sometimes they do. Right? It's not the only thing that they do. It's not the only important thing. I think we're totally in agreement that there's many different layers, one of which is political action. There's many important things to do. But one of the important things is to decide what you're going to say and do with your time and money in a society like the one we have. Like Michelle Alexander, in this book that Marla just mentioned, The New Jim Crow, points out that there's more black people in prison or on parole now than the total number of people that were enslaved in 1850. It's huge, shocking numbers that make the United States an extreme outlier, one of the, you know, not just wasting money, not just the humanity of the people in prison, but just like, when I talk about American exceptionalism, we're exceptionally prison-oriented, right? And a lot of the people that are in prison, a lot of people who are guards, a lot of people paying for it, are Christians, whether we talk about it or not. We've got the extreme skewing of wealth that Marla just talked about. That has ramifications for how much all of you all are going to make when you get out of here, if you're lucky enough to get a job, how many loans that you have, right? So I'm interested in the part that Christian thought and action can do in making a constructive contribution to that. And if you're only trying to build on a Christian base, it's way too narrow. But usually, if we've had social movements that have made a constructive difference, it's been quite likely that the churches have been there in force as part of it. One of the scholars that I like the best talking about this is a guy named Christian Smith. Some of you probably have read Christian Smith. He has a really good book about the conditions under which liberation theologies emerged in Latin America. And we're thinking about Pope Francis. That's a really good book to understand him. He also has a guy that riffed off his book called Doug McAdam, who wrote a book called Political Process and the Development of Black Insurgency in the Middle Years of the 20th Century, one of the better books about where the civil rights movement came from. And Smith said that there have been people trying to fight racial injustice in the United States in every generation, but often they just get beaten back and lynched. So what are the conditions for possibility for it succeeding that made it work? And Smith and McAdam both are using the same theory. They both posit that you have to have a political grievance. That's not a problem for racism, not a problem for poverty. You have to have enough resources to have a reasonable chance of success, so you're not just going out and getting run over by a truck on a suicide mission. But that's not enough. You have to have a three-legged stool. The opportunity, the resources to have a reasonable chance of success, some of which can be things like Spelman College and churches, alliances with politicians and so forth, lots of kinds of resources that you can use. But if you can't imagine the difference, then you're still not going anywhere. It's like a truck that's ready to roll, but you don't have the imagination to drive it anywhere. So it's a three-legged stool. The grievances that we have plenty of, we can all think of them. Resources, however many we have for realistic action. And insurgent consciousness is what Smith and McAdam talk about. Well, that's what Christians talk about as imagining doing the will of God. Imagining the utopian future that could come if Christians are faithful enough. And if we don't have some version of that utopian imagination of hope, many versions of which are Christian, there's just not going to be a movement that succeeds. So I'm always looking for that. We can talk about different kind of case studies. It seems to me that right now the foundational problem is not that we can't see that there's problems with the prison industrial complex or the government shutdown or whatever it is we want to talk about. It's that, where is the hope? That's the problem that is bothering me. I don't know. We can talk about whether the rest of you see it that way or not. But I think we don't want to say that it only can come in forms of religion, evangelical Christianity, whatever it could be, but that's a place where religions have things to contribute. Religions do have resources. They have colleges, pension funds that they can invest or divest, churches that have budgets, human resources that they can bring to bear on the resources part. And maybe in some cases, if we're saying true and useful things about social justice issues, we can bring a form of, I'm just going to call it utopian imagination, right? But often in theological forms of particular kinds of hope about, where you would talk in Christian terms about following Jesus or trusting in God. So faith wouldn't be a assent to a proposition. It would be participating in pursuing some kind of vision like that, making it not the only priority, but one of the priorities of churches. So I'm always on the lookout for that. I think if you have your antenna out for that sort of thing, you can see it all over the place. Sometimes it's depressing because it's the minority, but whether it's the majority or the minority, that's what I'm hoping we can talk about, how we see that now, today, in relation to issues of race and justice.
Thank you. Thank you both for beginning this discussion, opening up this conversation. We've been talking, just to sort of recap, we've been talking about faith, the place of faith, this tension between faith and justice, how the two come together. We've been talking about these components that are needed for actual change, lasting change, change that is important and real to really manifest itself. Where would you like to take the discussion from here? It's up to the two of you.
Well, you said several things that really made me think. And one of the questions you asked is, where is the hope? And I would add to that, where is the sense of urgency? Right? I'm not convinced that we have a sense of urgency around the real problems that our society faces. And oftentimes, even in Christianity, I think we feed into the problem as opposed to critiquing the problem. And for example, if we think about the wealth gap, right? Oftentimes, it's our own sense of individualism that makes us feel that people are entitled to the wealth that they earn, right? We think, well, why would we tax people more? Because they're entitled to their earnings. And so sometimes even the language of Christian individualism doesn't do enough to critique the ways in which tax structures change. We don't have the same tax structure in 2013 that we had in 1970, which is why we have industry leaders making hundreds times what their actual employees make, right? This didn't exist in the early 1970s, and yet oftentimes when people initiate conversations like that, which challenge a tax code, there's a way in which people can be pigeonholed into being named simply socialist, right? Which doesn't start an honest conversation, right? Because if Mark is talking about bringing around and having a conversation around truth, we have to start with facts that are indeed facts, and then start from there to engage in a conversation about how we critique society. But oftentimes in our political debate, the right and the left are so engaged in trying to win the conversation as opposed to trying to tease out the truths and the issues in the conversations that we don't ever get to that place.
Totally agree.
You can't agree.
We need someone to disagree with us up there.
One of the other things I wanted to talk about, even as we're thinking about churches, it's so easy, even as I was writing about evangelicals, mm-hmm. right? There's such a diversity of evangelicals, right? Even when I talk about, people say, well, what is the black church doing? There's such a diversity of black churches. Different scholars have created different models for thinking about black churches. Two scholars, Beyer and Singer, argue that they're mainstream churches, which are engaged in the political process, which are interested, which are vested in American ideals of capitalism, et cetera. They're trying to send their kids to college so that they can become functioning, adaptive members of society. Then they say there are conversionist sects. And when they say conversionists, they mean they're people who go to church and want to instead of being engaged in this world, they're interested in the next world, right? So they're otherworldly. Then they say that there are groups that are thaumaturgical, that believe, well, this may be how the American system works. Capitalism works like this. You have to go out, you have to go to school, get an education, and once you get an education, you can become fully employed. Sure, that works for the average person, but in thaumaturgical, what they call thaumaturgical groups, it's more like if you can think it, you can believe it. If you can name it, you can claim it, right? And so you can bypass all that other stuff that everybody else has to do, and simply by sheer will of faith, you can manifest physical realities from the depths of your spiritual well. And then they say, well, they're black nationalist sects, which don't want to have anything to do, they would argue, with mainstream culture. And so there's a constant critique of American life and American values, they would say, in nationalist communities. So even in that four-pronged, there are so many other ways of thinking about it. C. Eric Lincoln and Lawrence Mamiya created dialectics, where they said black churches exist on dialectics between resistance and accommodation, between otherworldly and thisworldly, between universalist and particularist, right? So there are a multitude of churches within the black church framework as well as within evangelicalism, and you can say the same thing about white Baptist denominations. You can say the same thing about Presbyterians. There's such a plethora of religious communities out there. It's important that we don't pigeonhole, even in our language and conversation tonight, what churches and communities are doing or not doing.
Yeah, I mean, that in a way, that restates something that I hope I was getting across when I said it's a wide-open language. You're just talking so far mainly about just varieties of black, of right. Majority African-American Christianity. But we could say that about Christianity at large, that it's all over the place. We could say that about liberalism and socialism, too. You just dropped
right.
The word socialist before.
Right.
Socialism could refer to Lenin, could refer to Stalin, could refer to Chinese before and after. The Chinese is where they make your IMAX, right? Now that it's still communist, but somehow capitalist at the same time. Could be the Swedes, could be all different kind of scholars that try to reduce everything solely to the what they call the economic base, reduce everything there, so you know whatever kind of religion is there just has to be a mirror reflection of the base. Or it could be a kind of sophisticated Marxianism that just tries to connect whatever the preachers are saying or the singers are singing to a more robust sense of a whole mode of production that's far more than just wage labor. It's all Marxian, right? You can distinguish it all from other traditions. You could trace it back to a certain kind of common language, but what matters is whether you're steering for the most true and useful directions within that. Same thing with liberalism. Liberalism, to some people, means what we call conservatism. Now, laissez-faire capitalism is classical liberalism. And then you have all different flavors of reform liberalism. And then people that don't like that, so they say they're progressive. And some of them are moving more towards socialism, and some of them are becoming neoliberals. So what does liberal mean politically, we don't know. And then on top of that, there's something called liberal theology that evangelicals have been taught not to like. So like, you have to define what you're talking about, whether we're talking about socialists or talking about liberals or talking about Christian faith. Most of the action is trying to decide how to discern what a true and useful way to be liberal, Christian, whatever, within a range. It's not an infinite range where it can mean anything. There can be more persuasive and less persuasive versions of the conversation. But I think if we're a Veritas forum trying to get closer, I think Veritas means truth, right? How do we find the, not just propositions, but priorities that seem persuasive, let's say, true and appropriate to the context we're in? All different kind of Christians are playing off Christian tradition, and then they're trying to discern the signs of the times. Pope Francis is really good on that. If you haven't read his article that's been all over the news, a lot of it's all about discernment. And you could certainly read a lot of it as liberal in the sense of New Deal politics and non-fundamentalistic theologies. But he's trying to discern what's the most appropriate way to deploy the resources, both the buildings, the money, and also the moral vision, the teachings of the Catholic Church, to do what's most true and useful. So I think the dialogue, I mean, at times I thought when you were first talking, you were talking a lot about Catholics and evangelicals, and I was, well, you know, where are the liberal Protestants here? Well, if you don't know what liberalism means, and the Pope might be one of them, or if Willie Barber might be one of them, then they're there. But there's this whole other group we can triangulate in addition to evangelicals and Catholics, which is the whole world of liberal Protestantism, too.
Yeah, and oftentimes African-American Christians are somehow in the middle of all of that conversation, right? Seen as evangelical in theological orientation and liberal in social orientation. And so how then to place Black Christians is always a question that scholars wrestle with.
Yeah.
So we get this category, Black Christianity, and so we're not lumped in with evangelicals, and sometimes we're not even lumped in with liberal Christians. Because there's a very complex history to the development of Black Christianity and Black Protestantism in this country. It did not necessarily come, it came out of white Christian churches, the establishment of white Christian churches, but Black Christians needed autonomy and the right to be self-made men and women. And so in Black Baptist churches, Blacks came out of predominantly white churches and started their own Baptist churches. They came out of the larger Methodist church and founded the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And in each of those instances, the founding of the church was not simply based on an evangelical call for personal salvation, but it was rooted in a very real call for justice, and not a justice that was somehow based on pie-in-the-sky logic. But it was based on the ability for African Americans to live free and independent. And so whether it was with the founding of the AME Church or the founding of Black Baptist, you only have with the founding of African American Pentecostal churches, that's the first time that you had an interracial body founded in 1906 in California, where whites came out of a predominantly Black denomination. It was an interracial denomination. Whites left that and formed the Assemblies of God denomination. So that was the very first time that you had whites actually leave from a Black denomination to found the church, and not Blacks leaving from white denominations.
Interesting.
But rooted in the founding of the Black church was this deep concern about justice and about education, along with the saving grace of Christ. And so those themes have always been intertwined in African-American Christianity, to greater or lesser extent. How many of you all have seen The Butler? I made reference to it. So you've seen The Butler. So you see the tensions. I think that movie, with the flaws that people have talked about, that movie does a great job of actually talking about the very tensions that exist in African-American communities about what it means, what avenues people should take to pursue justice. Not whether justice should be pursued, but rather what avenues should be pursued.
I mean, I think it's probably been implicit in what we were saying, but it might bear repeating that I think I agree with what I was taking to be implications that you were saying, that one of the predominant themes that makes, if you're careful, holds as a generalization about African American Christianity in U.S. history, is that it's more concerned with social justice issues than the average white denomination is. Especially if you think in the South. Some of the early Baptists in the South where the whites came in and were Baptists, were trying to do interracial fellowships in the South under the regime of slavery, but they quite often just got run out of town on the rail, tarred and feathered. And so if they were allowed to like not have their churches burned down, they were preaching what seemed to most black Christians is kind of a bizarre gospel, where you could be brothers and sisters in Christ, but still one person would own the other one, could beat them, kill them, rape them with impunity. You couldn't share the Bible with your brother and sister in Christ because it's against the law for blacks to read. So, like, that really did a number on Southern white theology, because it's just so counterintuitive to the way most people thought before that. And I don't know, maybe somebody can read the Bible and think that that would sort of be a normal way to read the Bible, but it's hard for me to imagine that you would get that out of the Bible. You really have to kind of twist your mind into a kind of weird pretzel that's really been, I think, distorted by the social context. And that was the context in which, well, okay, individual salvation, we're reading the Exodus, and it's about the individual soul migration to heaven. It has nothing to do with Harriet Tubman trying to get these particular slaves to Canada or something like that. So that's the context in which black churches say, well, you know, whites should be learning from us about Christianity because we're not quite as screwed up by this experience of trying to be Christian under this slave regime.
Right, and not seeing a contradiction in that, because it mm-hmm. meets your own level of social comfort, right? It's, mm-hmm. It affirms a social system that you live in. That's when I talked about where all our Christianity, our faith walk is so informed by who we are, our race, our gender, our nationality. And so to be a slave owner and to have a religious system say that somehow your social world will be turned upside down if you release slaves, or if you read the Bible in a particular way, that means you give up your economic comfort, you give up your social comfort. And when you look at white Christianity, prior to the civil rights, to the Emancipation Proclamation, white Christians split over this issue of slavery. White Southern Baptists pulled out of the larger Baptist convention. There were Southern Baptists and then there were Northern Baptists. Same with the Methodist Church. There was a Southern Methodist and then there was a Northern Methodist over this issue of slavery. Even in the Methodist Church, there was a law that said if a mandate in the Methodist Church that if you owned slaves, you could no longer be a pastor, right? And so those kinds of issues caused this great division and ended up shaping, I think, what we've come to understand as Christianity in the U.S. We see the remnants of some of those kinds of tensions even as we live out our understandings of Christianity today, our commitments to justice or our lack thereof commitment.
Well, I was just going to say that, like, if we have sufficient agreement on that, I mean, then, like, the next question is, okay, what's changed before and after the two big racial revolutions, right? Reconstruction, before and after slavery, and then before and after the civil rights movement in the 1960s. I think most people in most branches of Christianity today now say, oh, no, we're glad we're not in the bad old days of slavery. We don't really think like that anymore. But traces of the individualistic and apolitical way of framing theology that I was just describing as a distortion are still in the water, right? There's other things in the water too, but there's still traces of these legacies that are hard to strike out. There's so many versions of it, but the one that I want to call attention to is the idea that to say that you're colorblind could be doing more harm than good to attack problems of institutional racism. If there's this huge problem of the prison industrial complex and you just don't notice it because you think everyone is equal now and we have a black president, right, then it's perpetuating institutional racism to be colorblind. It's better to be attentive to color and risk the charge that you're thinking too much from color than to be colorblind. And I think that that's probably the biggest sticking point right now in some of the emergent debates within Christianity. It's like, what to do with this idea that we're post-racial, we're colorblind, we just have to stop thinking about race because we've progressed beyond all the problems or something like that. And I think that that's, you'd have to take that case by case just like you have to take everything else case by case. But it's likely to be a problem, very often is, in my view.
Yeah. What's interesting about that is you asked what has changed significantly. One of the things that has changed significantly since the civil rights movement is the rise of evangelical and evangelicalism, Pentecostalism, and the charismatic movement, if you will. And you all probably well know that it is one of the fastest growing evangelical Pentecostalism around the world. And some people argue that it's fastest growing in the two-thirds world. And what's fascinating about that is it is often tied to these notions of color blindness. And even in my research now on televangelism, one of the things that I've noticed is there's definitely a lack of emphasis in talking about structural oppression, structural issues, because people don't want to buy that. We live in a world where much of what we've experienced over the last, since the 70s and 80s, has been a self-help revolution. So what people want to hear is a message about how my life is going to be better. Don't necessarily want to hear messages about the problems or the challenges or the social justice concerns that need to be addressed. There's a way in which, even in the prosperity gospel, when I think about what its impact around the world, religious broadcasting took off in the 40s, 50s, 60s. It turned from what they call sustained time programming, where programming was basically given to religious broadcasters because it was seen as a public good, a public service. By the 70s, it was seen as they were required to pay for the airtime. They moved to a period of what they call paid time programming. And so with paid time programming, there became this emphasis on fundraising because you had to pay for the airtime. And so when people think about, well, where did the prosperity gospel come from? A lot of it came from the New Thought teachings of the early 1900s, but much of it came from this advancement of media and religious broadcasting. And so people began to preach to people's felt needs, right? They began to preach to your money needs or to your health needs, so that, and then requiring or asking that you would send money in and promising that you'd get a financial blessing back. And in that way, it bypasses a need for even thinking about, well, why is this person poor in the first place? It skips over that to an immediate kind of a think and grow rich kind of possibilities, right? So we don't enter into a conversation about fair wages. We don't enter into a conversation about tax codes. We don't enter into a conversation about educational opportunities. All of those things are bypassed in a way where faith seems to fill this gap. Like, I'm trying to get from here to there, and as opposed to talking about all the steps in between, faith becomes this kind of cotton candy fill-all that just allows you to jump from one place to the other without really dealing with the hard realities that wealth in America is based on home ownership. Those who are wealthiest in America tend to be those who are educated. How do people get access to education? What are we doing as a government, as a community, to ensure that people have access to Pell Grants to go to college? These kinds of issues are the things upon which a middle class, a solid middle class, is born. But somehow our faith over the last 40 years or so It has not forced us to address these issues head on, but it's allowed us to kind of bypass that with the message of faith. And that, for me, has been a bit troubling to watch.
And even if you're in a form of evangelicalism that isn't caught up that much in prosperity gospel and is even trying sincerely to do racial reconciliation, it still can short circuit. I was thinking about this when I was reading your book mm-hmm. yesterday. There's a section about promise keepers mm-hmm. in between Sundays. And I don't know if any of you remember this. You know what the promise keepers is? They were in Thompson Bowling once and in Neyland Stadium once. Mm-hmm. And in 96 was what Marla was writing about. They were in Neyland Stadium. And I decided to try to get a ticket and go just to check it out. So I was actually there at the Stand in the Gap rally for the Promise Keepers. McCartney, so this is like a Christian men's organization, right? Men's Bible studies, and you go to rallies. And McCartney, who had been a football coach at Colorado, had this really strong Christian conviction that he wanted to work on racial reconciliation within evangelicalism. And they were making a really big deal of it. I think they had, what did you say? I think you had the numbers. 30% of the staff were African American within Promise Keepers. They were basically doing affirmative action. Mm-hmm. Like the only big shot leaders of evangelicalism at the time that ever, they probably didn't say affirmative action because they were all against it, right? But but they really wanted affirmative action in Promise Keepers because they wanted to make it multiracial. And I think McCartney was sincere about it. I don't have any reason to doubt that he was. But a couple of things about that. One was that it was a sort of narrowing and truncating. You were just supposed to confess your sins, the legacy of white guilt, and then get the black guys to forgive you. And then you were supposed to hug and make up. And that was supposed to build up from this personal sense of catharsis and reconciliation. And there's nothing wrong with that. But if you think about it in the context, it's very interesting to think about it, because this is the run-up to the election where they were trying to de-elect Bill Clinton. This was the run-up to 1996. Reagan and the first Bush had been elected by getting the swing voters that were the social conservative Democrats and picking off a few black Republicans here and there, right? Enough swing voters. Because Democrats always had traditionally voted Democratic, but the Southern Democrats then all slipped to Republican. So Reagan had to get some of these traditional Democratic voting Catholics that were really concerned about abortion, let's just say obsessed, since Pope Francis said it, we're allowed to say it. I mean, we're quoting. I didn't say it. Pope Francis did. They're obsessed with abortion. All right. Clinton then got them back in the 1992 election. 1996, it was really important to get some of these conservative Christians, including some of the black Christian vote, back in the anti-Clinton camp. And what was it, a couple of years before that was when Farrakhan did the Million Man March. It was within at least maybe a year, maybe 2 years at the most before that. Mm-hmm. And these guys were totally freaked out. There were a lot of people there, and they weren't all Nation of Islam guys. A lot of them were black, Pentecostal, just basic Baptist. Cornel West helped them organize it. It's a huge rally. So the Promise Keepers were trying to say, oh my God, we're not going to let Farrakhan lead these guys. We're going to have the Promise Keepers stand in the gap rally, which I call the Black Million Man, the White Guys Million Man March. the Million White Guys March. Right, and the Million Man March is the black guys stand in the gap. Mm-hmm. Really interesting to think about that. Mm-hmm. McCartney is totally sincere. They really want racial reconciliation in the circumscribed way that they're doing it. But the people that are hyping it, Pat Robertson, all these political operatives, like I don't know if Rove was around in those days or not, but the Karl Rovian types, were pushing Promise Keepers really hard, not because they cared one bit about racial reconciliation, because they wanted to get rid of Bill Clinton and get a Republican president in there. So all these layers were all going on at the same time. So it was totally sincere efforts at racial reconciliation that were rather interesting to me. But the more that they would have succeeded, the more it would have hurt black people in the long run. I mean, all these same people that they were trying to elect are the ones that are trying to strip out voting rights and so forth now. And internally, Promise Keepers imploded. Right. You were nice to them in the article. Well, we just don't know why they ran out of gas. But I think I know why they ran out of gas, right? And I had students, I had a grad student at the time that was in these circles and had friends that were being recruited for Promise Keepers. And they were fighting about the priorities of Promise Keepers internally, and the big money guys that were hyping it were withdrawing the money from it because they didn't, because the election was over, right? And they, so that's why Promise Keepers, that was definitely part of the reason that Promise Keepers ran out of gas, that they couldn't agree on whether to have robust anti-racism, and insofar as they could agree on it, they couldn't get the big money backers to back it. So a lot of sincere people were caught up in that, and Promise Keepers probably helped them in many ways, but you have to think about all the different levels at the same time to understand the total phenomenon that was Promise Keepers. So, I mean, I think both of us are agreeing. Think structurally about the big structural changes that are needed and how the resources of Christianity are linking up with it.
Yeah, I think one of the things that, when you said that, and thinking structurally, one of the things that comes up in talking about racial reconciliation is what you talked about, the kind of apology and then forgiveness rendered, which may be a first step. But the real work of reconciliation really does have to deal with addressing structural inequality. And again, for many Christians, there's a resistance towards government intervention, right? Because the idea is often presumed to be that, that small government is what is required. And yet, at the same time, when people articulate notions of small government, they mean small government often in service of the interests that are particular to them. And so when the notion of big government comes up, it seems as if it's more so social handouts to non-deserving citizens. And yet when you deal with issues of structural inequality, I think if I were to take my life, for example, and talk about the ways in which individualism, notions of individualism trump addressing structural inequality, I'm a professor at Harvard, I have a PhD. Most sociologists will tell you that children follow in the footsteps of their parents, right? So if your parents are college educated, you will probably be college educated. If your parents are middle class, then you will probably be middle class. Likewise, if your parents are poor, more often than not, you will be poor. And if your parents are uneducated, you will more than likely be uneducated. That's simply what sociologists explain to us. And so when you look at the long history of African-American struggle and African-American movement in the middle class, you have to ask about government intervention or the lack thereof. My father grew up sharecropping in South Carolina. And when he was in high school, his principal noticed something special about him. He said, "You need to be in somebody's college." Now, none of his siblings, no one suggested to his siblings that they needed to go to college or that there was a way to go for them to go to college. He just said, "I'm going to find a way for you to get to Morris College." Morris College is a small black, historically black college in Sumter. He said, "I'm going to call the president of Morris College and see if we can get you in at Morris." So he called the president, and he said that my father could come. Now, my dad had simply sharecropped and gone to high school in the off season. He graduated late because he spent much of his time in the fields. And so when he called the president of Morris College, Dr. Lun C. Richardson, Dr. Richardson said, send him, right? Send him on to Mars. So my dad went, and as he tells it, he had one pair of shoes, and his roommate had a pair of shoes, and so between the two of them, they had two pair of shoes. So they switch them out to make it look like they had more than one. And so he worked his way through college because he drove tractor. He's and drove school bus on the side. He could drive pretty well, and so the president hired him to work as his chauffeur for college. So that's how he earned his way through college. The president then told him that he needed to go to Atlanta University and earn an MBA. And so he said, we need to get you into AU. And so he sent him down to Atlanta so he could earn his MBA, which is where he met my mother. They got married and moved back to Sumter and had us. Now, why do I tell you that story? Because sharecropping, slavery and sharecropping, were institutions that were supported by the government. They were written into law. Black people could go certain places, black people couldn't go certain places. Black people couldn't get certain kinds of education. When someone picked my father out of a group of kids and said, you need to go to college, that was his individual initiative in trying to get my dad into a school. It wasn't a government program. A government program kept him from going to school, but no government program made an opportunity for him to go to school. As a result, if you look at my family, you'll see that the vast majority of my father's siblings didn't get to go to college, worked in factories, and lived the kind of hard, working class lives that many people continue to have to live. The issue is, if the government has historically, legislatively created a two-tier system in society, why isn't it not then the responsibility of the government to rectify that? Why is it then the responsibility, people would argue, of a kind of bootstraps logic, right? That people need to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. If the government has been so active in creating wealth for whites, so active in creating opportunity for whites to the exclusion of blacks in history, why then should not the government do the very opposite and create opportunities for African Americans? I think the most radical thing the government could have done in the 60s and 70s was create an opportunity for all African Americans to go to college and pay for it, right? That would have been radical social justice, right? Because it was a way of rectifying a wrong in society. We now live in an age that is people feel completely removed, and there's a way in which no one wants to talk about race, and where in which a notion of color blindness is seen as the utopian response. And yet when you look at the wealth inequality that we talk about, when we look at differences in education and in health, many of these things are legacies of a history of institutional racism that still have not been addressed. And to your point, to then not talk about race in the face of that is to then affirm that inequality exists simply because it exists. But it exists because there's a history in the country that has not been addressed.
And if you start looking for it, it's hidden in plain sight. I mean, I'll tell my white guy stories now. They're not as don't have as much oppression in them, but. My great-great-grandparents were about as close as you could come to being like a sharecropper, except they were just dirt poor in Norway and Sweden. They had to come to the U.S., and then they were really poor. My mother lost her farm in the Great Depression. And because of that, I came up lily white in Iowa, in a county that I don't think had any black people in the county. So I never really thought about this stuff until later. It's embarrassing to think about it. I had to go study in Mexico and understand the class structure of Mexico, and then I could understand the United States, finally. And then all these things that are hidden in plain sight. We still have extreme racial segregation, notwithstanding the fact that Oprah can live in whatever neighborhood she wants, right? But that's what structures access to decent unpolluted neighborhoods, decent schools, all kinds of opportunities just based on the neighborhood you live in. And you can say that's based on how much money you have, right? You should have worked harder, pulled yourself up by your bootstraps so you could move out with Oprah, right? This is what Romney said. These kids that want a job, why don't they ask their parents for money to start up their business, right? Well, maybe that's because their parents were property and all the wealth is in the pockets of their owners. Or the people, in my family's case, whoever owns that farm that my mother lost in the 30s. So it's hidden in plain sight just in the freeway system and the home loan system and the structure of the neighborhoods and the history. Why is there the wealth gap? Well, how about 400 years of slavery? Right? I mean, but if you think about it, it just goes really deep into everyday life, and it's not a thing of the past. It's an ongoing thing. And the government impact on that is really key. I'll tell a story from my family, right? I have a whole bunch of aunts and uncles. They all were really poor farmer types in the upper Midwest. It doesn't hold completely, but it holds quite strongly that the ones that became what we would call like successful middle class were the men who came of age after World War II. And others became farmers and wound up pretty poor. That was because of the GI Bill. You know who the GI Bill is? Anybody that fought in World War II got free education, right? Again, that's going to be less available to the women and less available to blacks. But it was a blanket advantage to anyone that was the right age to get the GI Bill then got the good education. And yeah, they worked hard, but it was enabled by the structure of the government programs. Same thing true of the ones that were able to buy the house in the suburbs, right, on and on like that.
And what would compel a Christian to want to rectify that kind of inequality?
Asking me?
Mm-hmm. Like what, I mean, I'm hearing us talk, and I'm thinking about how people might think about what we're saying. Like, what would compel someone who loves Christ to want to rectify that kind of inequality? Because it seems like so much work, and it seems like such a great sacrifice. And I'm not convinced that people would even imagine that that kind of sacrifice and that kind of work is feasible.
To like reinstitute better government support for education?
Yeah, because I think we live in a society that feels as though those kinds of reinvestments are taxing on hardworking Americans, right? There's a way in which if the language of much of popular okay. language suggests that people don't want to be taxed to All help right. out okay. somebody who's not really working hard and doesn't really want something better.
Well, I'll take a try on an example.
Okay.
We've got the prison industrial complex. I wrote down the numbers here. In the 20 years before 2007, the spending on the prison industrial complex rose five times from $11 billion to $47 billion spent on incarcerating people. And it's about five times as many. Many of them are there from stop and frisk type stuff, dubious stuff that clearly isn't equal justice under the law. Now, I think that if we took a small fraction of that $49 billion and created scholarships out of it instead, it would be good on a number of levels that Christians and anyone else who's thinking straight should get behind, right? Be better for everyone. Be less people unjustly jailed. Be less money wasted. We could spend money on whatever we thought the Christian thing to do would be. And I think the Christian thing to do is to fund healthcare and get people out of prison. Right? Certainly that's a very plausible reading of what you would get if you read the Sermon on the Mount, right? Spirit of God is upon me because he's anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to let people out of prison, to preach the acceptable word of the Lord. Jesus is running around healing people all the time. I think it's clearly a Christian priority that everyone should have health care, and especially if you're unjustly in prison, you should get out of there. If you're a biblical literalist, you let everybody out of prison, right? So everyone here that doesn't think that is picking and choosing. You're reading the Bible liberally, right, in the bad way, right? So many different reasons, some of which are self-interest reasons, some of which that it would just be good to have the common good be better, less people in prison, more people with health care, and there's a Christian warrant for it. I mean, it's hard to generate hope for it. That's why the Moral Monday thing interests me. The first thing that I asked Marla before, since she was at Moral Monday, like, were there enough people there that it actually seemed empowering? Right? Because I go to protests all the time in Knoxville, and I'm afraid that we're just dramatizing weakness. And I go home and I'm depressed. When I was in Wisconsin, when Scott Walker was trying to like destroy the teachers' unions there, you know who Scott Walker is? He's one of these right-wing Republicans, governors, trying to do all sorts of austerity stuff and really hurt both healthcare and the education system in Wisconsin. They basically did this huge mass occupation of the Capitol in Madison. Everybody marching around singing, and it's sort of like the Wisconsin version of Moral Monday. That was really exciting and empowering because they actually had a vision. They were trying to recall Scott Walker as a governor. They thought they were going to succeed at it. That's the kind of hope that we need, and that's why Moral Monday interests me. It seems like it has a little bit of traction. But I don't see why certain kinds of Christians getting behind health care shouldn't be able to have traction. It might be utopian, but I think it's utopian in the good sense of something that's at least as imaginable as possible. But that's the kind of utopia that's conditional on whether enough people catch the vision of it to actually make it happen, not just utopia as counterfactual and wasting time building castles in the air. It seems to me that it actually is attainable to have better health care in North Carolina.
I'm gonna just pause the conversation momentarily. Hasn't this been great? I wanna thank Professors Frederick and Hulsether for their conversation, their time here, and we're just gonna take a short break and invite you, if you're willing, to stay and ask some questions now of our scholars about this issue of faith and justice and how it manifests itself in our American life. All right, we'll go ahead and begin with our first question. So, gentlemen in the blue, go ahead.
Yeah, question for both of you. We've talked a lot in abstract terms about the problems that are affecting social change and perhaps ways that we should be motivated to get in and act ourselves. And in dealing with a lot of the structural problems, it is tough a lot of times to put our fingers on the issue. And like you all have said, there's been a lot of things like self-development movements in the past that have pushed us to focus on personal needs and things like that. So in lieu of asking for a quick fix, nonetheless, like Marla, like you suggested, a lot of us might be wondering, well, where do we start still tomorrow? And there's still so much. So is it the prisons that we start with? Is it, maybe you've mentioned getting more of a hyped movement going with protests and things like that? Is it gonna be more of a gradual vision casting change from person to person? How should we start to actually affect social change and get our hands dirty with the rest?
That's a great question. That's a really great question. I would say the number one thing to do is vote and make your voice known, right? Because so many of these things are legislative decisions. whether it's even when you think about Trayvon Martin and Florida, right? The standard ground laws, those laws don't have to be in effect, right? People have power to vote people in office and vote people out of office and make their voices known, whether they agree with standard ground laws or whether they disagree with standard ground laws. They're in effect now, they don't have to be in effect forever. But if we sit idly by and expect change to come from somebody else, then change will never come. But that it's up to you and you to get your friends out. I mean, it's hard work to motivate people. We are so consumed with our own individual lives, it's very hard to build coalitions and get people mobilized for a sustained period of time to make effective change. But it really does take that kind of effort. I'm so, and I'll let Mark speak, but I'm so impressed sometimes when I go back to my research site, back to Halifax County, because the people who make things happen in Halifax County are the senior citizens, right? They have the time, they have the energy, and they have the passion. They meet together on Tuesdays, they talk about what they have, somebody comes in and they preach, they sing, and then they get down to the business of talking about what's going on in our community and what do we want changed. And by the time they get through ironing out what they want changed, they have come up with a plan. And so it's that kind of effort and focus that I think we really need in our country. And senior citizens and college students are the people who can really make a difference.
It's such a good question, and I don't really have a good answer. I really think you have to think about it case by case. If you're guided by that conception of when social change is going to succeed that I was trying to introduce with Christian Smith and Doug McAdam at the beginning, I mean, it's important to look for places where there's an opportunity and you have the resources to actually make a dent in it, as opposed to just dramatizing weakness. And that's not a simple answer to the question either. It's still really abstract. And sometimes you have to stand up and take a risk. That's part of what the religious part of insurgent consciousness can do, is step out even if you're risking your life and sacrificing in some ways. Martin Luther King Jr., Rosa Parks, perfect example of that. King knew he was risking his life. But nevertheless, there was a political opening there in the aftermath of the court cases in the 1950s and the configuration of votes in Congress and the way Cold War propaganda was making the people in Washington be embarrassed about petty apartheid in the South. King still was risking being lynched when he stepped up with his vision, but the political opportunity was there. So if you're attentive for that kind of thing and you're willing to risk, that's going to be partly your own discernment about where you care enough about it to actually stand up and risk. The one thing that I might say as a place to look is that I think not only is our prison system and our healthcare system really broken right now, I think the education system is going to hell in a handbasket. And that was, I don't know if I closed the parenthesis on what I was saying about, okay, how about if we take some of this money we're wasting on prisons and just put it into scholarships? But that's, I mean, I'm not that much older than most of you students, but I can remember going to school when there was enough social support going into education because it was seen as a collective good for everyone to educate people, that there were a lot more teacher jobs that paid a lot better, you could get through college without racking up ridiculous amounts of debt, and we weren't under this austerity regime that was tolerating as much unemployment as we have. So I just think that the college students should be rioting in the streets and saying, no, I'm not going to take it anymore. I mean, especially if you're trying to go into... you know, you have a vocation as a teacher, and all these people, if I retire, they probably aren't going to replace me with somebody that gets paid a decent wage. They'll just replace me with a PhD student that's not even being paid a living wage. It's really broken, and students ought to be protesting to fix it.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, I just want to thank you for coming out first, so thank you for your time. And I'm drawn towards the injustice that I see that slavery hasn't been ended, that there's still modern day slavery in the form of human trafficking and forced prostitution. And I've even heard estimates from the State Department saying that there are around 27 million slaves worldwide and maybe 100,000 in the U.S. alone. So I'm wondering what we can learn from the struggle for emancipation and the civil rights movement that maybe the American church or just even American citizens that are interested in justice can apply to ending modern day slavery.
Well, you know, even if you have a very rigorous course of study at UT that doesn't allow you to pursue answers to questions like that, you probably have enough room to maneuver to study it and do a research project on it and make it part of your education at UT to learn what's being done about it, to have the facts at your fingertips, to be educating people about it. That would be one place to start, just like using your education as a context in which to think some of this stuff through. I wish I knew more about some of the Christian campaigns against some of this stuff. I just don't, but it's a really good question.
Yeah, I would agree that this level of educating oneself, educating others. There was what's the evangelical organization that met in January? This past Passion, and they raised over $1 million to work on this issue of human trafficking. I was so impressed with the students, right? I was so impressed with the level of sacrifice and the energy and the passion behind that cause, because that's really what it takes to make change. I know you can probably encourage your church. I know some churches have safe houses for women who've come out of human trafficking. I know Atlanta is one of the cities with a huge problem in human trafficking, and some of the churches there have set up safe houses for women coming out of the situation. So there are a number of different kinds of things that can take place. But I'm so glad that you're passionate about that issue, because it absolutely is a growing crisis in the country.
I don't know if you were thinking about like children that are trapped in sweatshop labor as a subcategory. It's a stone's throw from the categories you were mentioning. A year ago, there's a national campaign already ready-made, and there were some UT students that were trying to get UT to lobby the bookstore to not buy T-shirts and stuff like that that were made under sweatshop labor. And it was a whole other company that was started up. I don't know if it was a Christian startup or not, but one of these like moral business type things. And I think the powers that be at the bookstore didn't think they had enough power, but I think it's quite imaginable that we could create a big enough coalition to take another crack at a problem like that. It's not going to solve the problem as a whole, but it might be interesting to try.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, go ahead.
There's a tendency to there's a tendency to focus on maybe too much of one or too much of the other. And I was just wondering if maybe you could first talk a little bit about what you think that relationship is, maybe in the context of the Christian life. Is it something that's like a kind of codependence, they feed on each other, or like does justice flow from righteousness in the ways that you see Christian life practiced in Black communities? And then to Dr. Holsether, I guess I was just wondering if that may be a point where you might actually disagree or emphasize something a little bit differently from Dr. Frederick's, because you emphasize so much the kind of the justice aspect and the social aspect, and particularly how that can come from any number of sources. And so I'm just wondering if you think there might also be an interesting connection to the sort of personal righteousness that maybe also be incorporated there.
Yeah, what struck me in reading about justice and righteousness is the scholar's insistence that in the Old Testament, the word is the same, and it's often used interchangeably, right? So that in order to have righteousness, you have to have justice. In order to have justice, you have to have righteousness, that the two are mutually dependent upon each other. And when Jesus says in Matthew 23:23, "Woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites, you give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin." In other words, you do what is right, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former, right? So Jesus' mandate for us is that we do both and simultaneously. And I think what is powerful about that is I believe that's a high calling. I believe that's actually very difficult in our flesh to really do. And I believe that when Christ is commending that for his followers, it's a commendation of the work that God is to produce within us. It's not something that we can do in and of ourselves, because of course, human nature is to do the thing that you like to do most, as opposed to doing the thing that is simply required of you and expected of you. So I think it's a high calling. Bonhoeffer lamented the whole notion of cheap grace, right? You kind of get saved and then you don't have to do the weightier issues of the law, the doing of the justice and mercy and faithfulness. I think that's where the Holy Spirit comes in to really empower people to have them synergistically entwined.
Yeah, I know. I guess I don't think I really disagree. I suppose it depends on what you mean when you say righteousness, but I think I agree with everything Marla just said. One thing I tried to say at the beginning was that, you know, what I've been talking about is utopian imagination or insurgent consciousness or the amount of priority given to social change with the resources of, let's say it's the Catholic Church, going back to Pope Francis. It's not that all the things they're doing when they're not lobbying, either with their obsessions about gay rights, remember I'm quoting, right, and or immigration reform and or guns versus butter type stuff. It's not like that's the only thing going on in the Catholic Church that's important. But just that was the focus of our conversation, so that's what we naturally talked about a lot. I was raised Lutheran, so I was raised on the biblical proof text about that you're righteous in the eyes of God, not because you can do anything about it one way or the other, but because you're going to be flawed, but God is God of grace, so therefore faith is responding to that. I think a lot of Lutherans go off the rails by only reading that text and forgetting other ones. Luther tried to get the Book of James out of the canon because he thought it was so like crypto-Catholic or something like that when James said faith without works is dead. But I think it's true, faith without works is dead, right? I wrote that proof text down. if someone's naked and hungry, and you say to them, depart in peace, be warm and be filled, but don't give them the things that are needed for the body, what does it profit? That's also faith by itself. It doesn't have works, is dead. You believe there's one God, you do well. So do the demons. And I'm still quoting James here. Skipping ahead, a couple of verses. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. That makes perfect sense to me. I don't think spirit is reducible only to social action, but I think it goes together. So, so the people that talk about praxis, the ideas, the action, the social priorities, everything you're doing by your opportunity cost of not doing something else, there has to be a spirit to it. And you have to have enough resources to cope. Sometimes the best you can do is just get through the day and cope. That's what a lot of Marla's book is about. That part of the role of the church isn't necessarily being the place that's leading the charge for healthcare reform or whatever. It's just like some of the people whose spirit is such that they care about such things might wind up at the church and network there. But you don't necessarily, if you are using the church as your only base to push for healthcare reform, it's too narrow and you're going to fail. But that doesn't at all trivialize the importance of everything that happens at the church or the coping part. It's just that I would hold out for the importance to start keeping your eye on the ball of, like, if you're a UT student and you're just overwhelmed with coping, yeah, maybe that's all you need in a particular day. But if structurally, if there's a structural problem, you should see if you can get yourself to the point where you can imagine solving some of the other problems. And both of those things are both important, it seems to me.
Thank you.
We just have a few more questions, so we'll just, or we just have a few more minutes.
Sorry, I went
Sorry.
On
no,
too long.
No problem. Sorry. We did have a few more minutes, so we'll just take questions from those who are currently standing at this time.
So this works pretty well as a follow-up to his last question. You mentioned that a lot of our modern churches focus too much on righteousness at the expense of social justice. So my question is for both of you too. What, if any, distinction do you see between the role of the church and the role of the government in rectifying that disconnect?
Can you rephrase the question?
Sure. Should we try to do that social justice through our church or through the government, essentially?
I see. One of the things I think churches are effective at is communicating the mandates of Scripture, communicating the truths of Scripture. I'm not necessarily convinced, and this is part of Between Sundays, that organizing necessarily has to take place in the church proper. But I believe that Christians properly inspired or fully inspired can take that inspiration into many realms to affect change, whether it's advocating through public policy initiatives, whether it's getting involved in nonprofit organizations and the work that they do. I think that what is needed is the inspiration, the hope that Mark talked about. And I don't necessarily know that comes across enough in pastoral ministry sometimes. I think sometimes there's a focus so much on individualism that we miss that God has called us not only to take care of us and ours, but to take care of a larger community and world. And that kind of impetus, that kind of spirit is what's needed to go out into the world and affect change. Because I'm even a little wary of churches taking political sides.
Sure.
You know, I think that can have, it can often have a kind of negative effect on the body of Christ actually operating as a body of Christ. As any church, you will have Democrats and you will have Republicans, and for the pastor to preach a word condemning Democrats or to preach a word condemning Republicans, et cetera, I think it can do, it can actually do harm in some ways. At the same time, that message that we have to affect change, that we have to engage in social change, I think that is a clear mandate of the scripture.
I think, yeah, I would just want to take it case by case. Sometimes the government's the problem, so you have to attack it from outside the government. Probably it's not going to work if it's just church, because there's so many different kinds of churches anyway, and that implies Christian. So quite often you're going to need Jews, Muslims, neo-pagans, secularists all working together to attack whatever problem you want. So we have to triangulate it, or whatever the word that goes with seven instead of three, right? This or that social movement, this or that coalition, and just take it case by case.
Thank you.
Thanks. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Frederick, I was really interested in the beginning of your talk when you talked about the modern day difference between morality or spirituality and justice. And I was wondering for you both, what effect on that mindset maybe the growing separation between church and state has had, particularly in the issues of same-sex marriage and abortion. And I'll take my question off the air. That's okay.
You threw a lot in there on the end. Will you say your question
sure.
again?
Sure. in this mindset of a separation between spirituality and morality and then justice, how has that been influenced by the growing sort of de facto separation between church and state? In particular, I've heard a lot, you know, of people trying to argue that you should separate your spiritual views and your justice views because of some of these issues. What's your response to that? Is that clear?
No? So, like, would an example be that you could be spiritually opposed to contraception, but you still think people have the right to contraceptives, that sort of thing?
Right. Well, a lot of people who maybe support banning same-sex marriage out of a religious reason, the counter-argument to that is you should separate your moral views and your views of justice, which is sort of the opposite of what you're saying, and I was wondering how you would address that. Does that make...
Yeah, I followed you the earlier part, and I think you said it right. Like, if you don't agree with contraception, but you believe that people have a right to contraception, is that what you're saying? Those kinds of things? Or you don't necessarily agree with gay marriage, but you believe that people, you know, pay into American government, pay taxes, and thus have a civil right to the same kind of privileges that heterosexual married couples have. Is that
not even directly, just as sort of, since we do have this separation of church and state now that we didn't have 80 years ago, how has that mindset affected our mindset of separating this private and public sphere?
Yeah, but I think we've always, at least the Constitution, there's a way in which the notion of the separation of church and state has always been there, and I think it's invoked at different points in history for different reasons. And to your point, I think individual Christians really do have to work this out. I mean, I don't have a blanket answer for people when it comes to this issue. Because I know that people have moral convictions about certain spiritual moral convictions about certain things, and yet also see the kind of civil rights issues involved, whether it's, you know, the one we talked about contraception, or whether we're talking about gay marriage, or even whether we're talking about abortion. Some people are adamantly opposed to abortion, but don't necessarily think that they have a right to tell people that the government has a right to say that women shouldn't be allowed to have an abortion. So I think Christians are across the spectrum on that issue. I don't know if I'm answering a question. I think I am, but I really can't give the final answer on that. I do know that Christians wrestle with it daily, because at the end of the day, you're responsible. People are responsible to the public, but they also feel a huge responsibility to God in a way in which God is their final answer, and so they have to have a sense of conscious, clarity of conscience as they relate to God. So I really don't have a definitive answer as to how people should make those kinds of decisions.
I mean, the basic constitutional law is that Congress should make no law respecting an establishment of religion, nor prohibit the free exercise thereof. And that's why it's just messy and there's no consistency, because it's two rights. If you want to have to establish something, then you always, like if the majority of the people in the town want to have prayers at the graduation or something like that, I mean, they're establishing it, which they're not supposed to do, but they're exercising their religious freedom, and somebody has to decide, so it goes to the court. And there's just no kind of pattern that I've ever been able to discern. So I'm not sure if I agree with the premise that it's changed all that much. It just seems like it's been murky right from day one. The first time it came up was over polygamy with Mormons. The guy said, you know, I think I'm going to go to hell if I can't practice polygamy. And the court said, you can believe whatever you want, but you still can't practice polygamy. Right? So you can... So it's kind of incoherent.
Right.
And, you know, some of them are, you know, under the regime of prohibition, are Catholics allowed to use communion wine? Right? And it winds up in court. Or if the government says everyone has to salute the flag and say the Pledge of Allegiance, but you're Mennonite and you think it's against your religion to salute the flag because it's idolatry, then do you go to jail? Who gets to not go into the military, right? Quakers don't nice white Quaker upper middle class people don't have to go to the Vietnam War, but when Muhammad Ali said it was against his religion to fight because he was a Muslim and Allah told him not to fight unjust wars and Vietnam was an unjust war, it's like, sorry, you're going to Vietnam. So it's really murky. All those examples, like, what's the pattern there? Maybe someone is smarter than me that can see the pattern, but I just think it's rights in conflict, and the court's trying to muddle through as best it can.
Yes, go ahead.
Sorry, his question was very provoking. Kind of, you know. We were talking earlier about you know, writing social injustices, you know, throughout the past and how it affects culture, you know, in total, and it's more specifically, you were saying African American culture. We have a thing here called Sex Week at UTK, and last year it caused this, because we're mostly in the Bible Belt, it caused this kind of uproar of, you know, parents saying that they didn't want their kids to participate in, you know, such things because of the, I guess, stigma behind sex. And, you know, I guess, you know, because they're paying for college, they don't want their kids to be exposed to certain things, which I don't know how, you know, sex and college kind of go simultaneously. But anyway, my question is, well, a pastor, I'm not sure if it was on campus or off campus, but it was in the Daily Beacon, which is one of our school's newspapers, and it was basically saying that they feel like that after Sex Week, we needed a week of repentance upon Sex Week. Sex Week was is just basically telling people how to have sex responsibly and, you know, taking responsible actions towards sex, and having a healthy sex life. But of course, the church preaches, abstinence and whatnot. So my question is, do we as a church, keep pressing abstinence, or kind of make it into where we teach people to have a healthy sex life and actually, communicate with their sexual active partners and whatnot, so on and so forth, even in other cases like, masturbation and whatnot, because, our government is trying to pass, I think they have already passed a law and put about $2 million towards teaching kids from birth, especially in elementary school, about, sex and masturbation and having, a responsible sex life. It's been trialed and everything else. I don't know if it's actually been put forward, but I know a lot of money has been put forward, the research of it going forward. So, yeah, where does the church place in that subject?
Is that all you want to know? Goodness. Well, I always think that education is power, right? So I'm not an advocate, and I'm speaking for Marla. I'm not an advocate of people being uninformed. I think too often in an attempt to protect people, the church can often leave young people uninformed about their sexuality, their bodies, the risks of sex, and even sometimes what is taught to young people is not a realistic even view of marriage. There's a book called Making Chastity Sexy. Have you all read it? It's a scholar at a Christian college wrote about the abstinence movement and how much of the abstinence movement is framed around encouraging college students or young people to believe that abstinence only will end up, it's almost a version of the prosperity gospel, right? So if you save yourself before marriage, you get married, then it's going to be blissful and wonderful, and you're going to have great kids, and you have a great husband, all because you waited to have sex before you got married. And she said, and what doesn't happen in that conversation is the truth that oftentimes people can wait until to have sex until they're married and often end up with an awful sex life, or possibly marry a partner who had sex before they got married and end up with an STD, right? So saving yourself before marriage doesn't necessarily guarantee that you're not going to get an STD. Or you get married and you're not able to have children. There are all kinds of issues that can come up when once one gets married. And so the way in which the abstinence only campaign has kind of created a Cinderella-like story for young evangelicals has posed a problem often for people when they get to the realities of marriage. What she offers instead is the idea of chastity not as an avenue towards a perfect life, but chastity as a spiritual discipline, right? It is a discipline that allows you to focus on your relationship with God. And the scriptures are very clear about the benefits of that. And I think when you, when I think about the scriptures, when it talks about, I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. It's like, why would someone commit to abstinence? It's not because at the end of this road, I'm going to get married and have a great sex life and a wonderful husband. That may or may not happen, right? If you commit to that, it's because it's simply a reasonable service. It's a sacrifice in honor of what Christ has already done for us on the cross, right? That is a high ideal to teach young people. But I think it's a worthy ideal to teach young people. It's a high ideal, but it's a worthy ideal. And I also know that the culture of college and the ways in which you all are inundated, oh my gosh, with so many sexual messages, you almost have to be Mother Teresa, you know, to like withstand all of that, because whether it's the internet, I mean, we didn't even, I had the internet, I think, I don't know. I don't think I really had the internet in college, but just all the stuff that comes.
I didn't, because I'm old enough to not have
all the stuff that comes at young people. I think you ought to be guarded with lots of information, and I think you ought to, and I don't want to say ought to, I think it's a worthy goal to try to live one's life, live chastity as a spiritual discipline. I do think that's worthy.
It's such a complicated question.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really important. So let me just like tag team and say I agree that like Christians should not be complicit in disinformation about this stuff, and that I don't see any reason why you couldn't make a strong evangelical argument for better sex education across the board. And let me add to that that I think that we need to have good information if someone talks about the biblical teaching about sex or the biblical teaching about the family. There's often stuff that I think is just arguably disinformation about that. The idea that Jesus was for the modern bourgeois heterosexual family as we know it, it's just clearly not true. There's warrants for polygamy, there's warrants for celibacy. Nobody thinks about that very much. A big part of Catholic teaching that Francis was talking against, as has been mentioned before, is the idea that sex is mainly a bad thing. It's mainly part of fallen human nature, and through much of Christian history that's been like, and that's what you expect, because sex goes with women and women goes with lust, and that's mainly a bad thing, and we need to get beyond it. But it could be a good thing if it's for procreation in the right kind of family, which isn't necessarily going to be a modern nuclear family. It could be a good thing in polygamy in the Bible, but you could say that one theme is that sex is mainly sinful and it's about women and bad stuff unless it's for having babies. But that's a really narrow reading of some parts of Catholic tradition and some parts of the Bible. And there's other parts. And everybody that says the Bible is supporting the regular nuclear family and forgets polygamy is reading the Bible selectively too. So let's look at all the parts of the Bible and let's think about which ones are the ones that we want to preach on. Now, what a lot of Lutherans would say there is that sex is not only for procreation, it's for pleasure, which is a gift from God, which at least was true in the Garden of Eden, and maybe some of it continued, right? God wants us to be happy, and God wants couples to bond, and sex is part of how couples bond, and that's a good thing. And if you take that and look for warrants in the Bible, you can find a lot of them, and they're not all opposite sex couples. There's Naomi and Ruth that seem to be bonding, and we don't know for sure if they're having sex, but David and Jonathan look like they are. If you read with your antenna out for it, it's a perfectly plausible reading, right? So it's not easy to see what the biblical teaching about things like sex and procreation is. And you can run the argument that sex is a bad thing if it's not bonding the couples together and it's some version of exploitation or rape or something like that. Some of those bad things could be happening in normal nuclear families. There could be such thing as marital rape that's a bad kind of procreative sex because it's not for the upbuilding of the couple and the upbuilding of the kingdom of God. And if you grant that, then it's, you know, you're getting on thinner and thinner ice as you go, right? But you could also say conversely that some forms of good sex might not be in the form of straight married families. Like if you're not wired to be straight and it's against the law to have gay marriage, then are you just condemned to not have a relationship with sexuality ever? And is that what the Bible really teaches? Right? It's very contentious. I mean, we're not going to have disagreement about that. But there are Christians that make that argument that defensible kinds of sex that can be backed up by defensible readings of the Bible don't have all straight sex for procreation over here and every other kind over there, that you have to discern what's true, right? Everybody already grants that if you're past the age of having babies, it still could be good for couples to have sex, right? Because it's a gift of God and it keeps the couples happy and so forth. But you can take that idea and run with it and say, well, you know, David and Jonathan were like that too, and it was in the Bible. Or that you just don't want to think about sex as mainly a bad thing unless you're having babies, right? Like, is that really the heart of the Christian tradition that we want to carry forward, or is it not, right? So we have to really stop and think carefully about it. So I think that when Francis said in this interview that we have to be careful not to get too obsessed with just particular kinds of procreative sex in particular contexts, or the moral edifice of the church could crumble, this was one of the things that he was talking about. When the liberal Protestants that tend to be demonized by the evangelicals made the turn, this was mainly in the 60s during the sexual revolution, my second book that Matthew was talking about this magazine, Christianity in Crisis, made the turn, which most evangelicals were not making at the time, but the liberal Protestants did, saying that it might not necessarily be a sin in every context for college students to have sex with each other. Right.
So education
is... The argument was overtly the same argument that Francis made, saying, you know, we want to be credible here. The Bible said no sex outside of marriage, but they were being married when they're 16 years old. Right? Do we really want to just import that literally to the 20th century now when people aren't getting married until they're in their 30s? Or if we do that and all the kids vote from their feet thinking the church just is a bunch of old fogies and irrelevant, have we won the battle over sexual teachings, holding the line straight, and lost the war because, as far as the kids are concerned, the moral edifice of the church crumbled because we were obsessed with college students not having sex? See how that goes? I mean, there's been absolutely no agreement among Christians about that, and there's certainly a big war in the Catholic Church about it now, but it's not totally easy for me to see who the good guys and bad guys are.
Complicated question.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
One of the things a woman, she says in the book is that the ideal of abstinence until marriage is something that is worked out, she says, feasibly through one's 20s. And after that, it just seems, to your point about the length of time that people wait, it just becomes more and more difficult. And so I do think that's an issue that the church has to address very honestly with a generation that's aging and was taking more time to get married.
Last two questions.
Manuel, what a question. How to follow that. Well, I guess that's what I get from driving up here from Atlanta. Well, I appreciate the conversation. interesting and stimulating. I have a comment, wanted to see what you thought about. But using kind of your analogy, Dr. Fredericks, about the Pentecostal church and the formation of the Pentecostal church, early Los Angeles, out of that comes, arises the Church of God in Christ, and out of that comes the Assemblies of God. But how the how a particular praxis comes out of the work of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and using that as a model, as a kind of how does one begin to attack a lot of these issues that we're talking about in social justice. I'm wondering, to what degree does our praxis come out, or to what degree is our praxis devoid of a foundational theological orthodoxy? You know, one who's taught in theological institutions, I've been, frankly, the beneficiary of some messed up theology on this kind of mainline Protestant side, but also a kind of privileged theology that's also what you may find within the evangelical theological circles. And this kind of ideological readings, I call them a kind of bogus ideological readings, that seem to privilege particular agendas that are devoid of a foundational theological orthodoxy, where you begin to see true, in honor of Veritas, truth, or true works, social justice, because I'm wondering to what degree are our readings, particularly if we're wired towards social justice or wired towards a kind of political justice or advancement, we tend to strip Christianity or strip the biblical text from its theological orthodoxy, and tend to privilege or favor a particular agenda that has no grounding or has no organic roots within any organic communities. I've experienced both sides in that kind of sense, this kind of messed up ideological readings that seem to privilege a particular, because sometimes we see in the biblical text, God is more interested in the salvation of particular communities, and justice or social justice or political justice that we may want to invoke this human, kind of human interest, we just don't see that. And so that results in a kind of, and I just want to see what your thoughts are, that results in a kind of reading the biblical text in a kind of secular humanist lens, frankly, dressed in Christian drag.
I think that theology throughout history has been, and did I say this? Either I said this tonight or in my class. But I talk about it as a three-legged stool.
Yep.
There's traditions inherited from the past. There's the Bible, and then there's context. And not all contexts are secular humanist or social justice oriented. Some of the context could just be, I'm dying, right? I'm sick, I'm really depressed. But they're all moving targets, because context are things you have to take case by case and discern what's most important. And the tradition is really heterogeneous, and the Bible can be used in really noxious ways to do things like defend Nazis in the Spanish Inquisition and polygamy, or really beautiful things. So I guess I'll stand with Pope Francis again, mm-hmm. since I'm out on thin ice. I mean, I think that what theology is discernment.
Mm-hmm.
So it tracks us back to what I was saying before. You know, you have this theological language that you can do beautiful things with, but let's try to say the best things that we can. Yeah, I mean, do these problems happen? Yeah. That's what we're trying to avoid.
Yeah. But I think we have to be aware of uh-huh. that, you know, aware uh-huh. of our own sensibilities uh-huh. when we're constructing and working
sure.
out theologies. One of my favorite books is a book called God's Long Summer.
any of you read it? God's Long Summer by a guy named Charles Marsh. And it's about the summer of 64. And what he does is he goes through this book. It's such a great title, God's Long Summer. He goes through and he talks about the different perspectives of people who are pleading to God for God to act on their behalf. So he starts off the book with Fannie Lou Hamer. And Fannie Lou Hamer has been beaten while in prison, beaten mercilessly because she dared to get on a bus and try to go vote. And so it's about her pleadings to God to work on behalf of this poor community in the rural Mississippi Delta. And then the next chapter is about a white pastor who is also pleading for God, that all of this tension would kind of die down and people would basically adopt this notion of gradualism, that change will come. All these troublemakers don't need to be causing all this trouble. And so it's about his pleading to God. And then the next chapter is about a white Klan member who's pleading to God that God would help reestablish the race as it ought to be, the races, the order of the races as they ought to be. And the last chapter is about another white pastor who's getting involved in the civil rights movement. All that to say, all of these people think that God is on their side. And it goes to this theological point that you reference, I believe, because it talks about how our context informs sometimes our pleading towards God and the ways in which we then take theology to use it in our own service. And I think the best way to guard against some of those problems is to be very cognizant about where you're situated and where the scriptures are situated and the complexities around even thinking about engaging in social justice efforts. Whose interests are being served and why am I looking into these interests being served? Am I concerned about the least of these as Christ would be concerned? Am I asking those questions of myself? That's a best answer I can give.
Thank you. Final question.
Hi, my question is about racial reconciliation, particularly in the body of Christ. And you mentioned the promise keepers and basically how that was addressed, but not from a purely righteous perspective and wanting to actually see reconciliation take place. So how would you suggest we as the body of Christ open our eyes to the reality that there is a long history of racial tension in the United States, but that we do want to move forward to affect change socially, which means that we have to be on one accord. And are you aware of any movements in the body where we have really set and addressed our long history as brothers and sisters in Christ and where God is calling us to go now, particularly in regards to addressing the needs socially in America and in the world?
Well, I was saying some things that I didn't like so much about the Promise Keepers, but
right.
Let me just make sure I was clear that I commend McCartney for his sincerity.
Right. And
I don't think that it was trivial, the kind of reconciliation that happened there.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually think...
Or even starting the conversation.
I think it's actually kind of cool that when they actually decided they wanted to do something, they had to do what was de facto affirmative action.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I've gotten a lot of mileage out of that in my classes with people that don't think affirmative action could ever be good. I said, well, the Promise Keepers did it. And it actually succeeded,
mm-hmm.
at least for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
There's no silver bullet to
right.
solve this problem,
right.
that's for sure. Yeah, I just don't, I mean, I guess one of the things that I hoped from the conversation would be that we could put the problem on the table, which is the one that you just summarized really well for us as a sort of concluding question, and then sort of think together about what the next step might be. But it seems to me if we take it at the level of what's the Christian position or the Christian movement to attack it, that's probably the wrong level at which to attack it, because it's just too heterogeneous a problem. Sometimes I think it's appropriate really to target the problems of racism straight on. But not always. It depends on the case, right? There's so many important things that we could do. If we had a really good single-payer healthcare system, right now just expanding Medicare to everyone, that would be a tremendous help to the poorest people in the United States, and that would be disproportionately Black and Latino folks. But that wouldn't be to attack it at the level of race straight on. There's problems in the prison system that aren't only racialized, but that is probably more to do with race. With either one of those, there's lots of important ways that you could attack that as Christians. So I'm afraid I just don't have a good answer to the question, but there's lots of people out there that I could point to that have pieces of the puzzle of the question, one of which would be the Promise Keepers, one of which would be others coming out of different kind of Black church things.
Sojourners.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's a good suggestion. Why don't you?
I was just saying Sojourners, Jim Wallace. I think Jim Wallace does a really great job of trying to understand race issues from the perspective of the people that are negatively affected by it. And I think that's the best way to start addressing race and racism. You have to actually want to understand the perspective and the concerns of racial profiling. To just kind of dismiss it offhand as something that happens occasionally. When Black men in New York are, I have a friend who wears what he calls a uniform. He got tired of being thrown up against the wall by police officers from wearing jogging suits and jeans. And so he doesn't wear jogging suits, and he doesn't wear jeans anymore. He only wears a suit because he wants to communicate a message that he is somebody to be respected, right? And that's only because he's in a Black body, right? And so when Jim Wallace wrote about racial profiling, wrote about even the Trayvon Martin case, I feel like when people want to take the time to understand the perspective of those people, those who were negatively affected, I think that's the only time that real racial reconciliation can happen.
I mean, the idea of Sojourners is, like, as a concrete takeaway, that's a really good place to end, because y'all know what Sojourners magazine is, who Jim Wallace is? I'm sure some of you do. Others don't.
Google him.
I mean, he was a white guy around my age, a little bit older, that was sort of like a evangelical hippie type, but a little bit more intellectual, a little bit more activist than some of the hippies. And he started a Christian commune, basically like a house church. I think it was in Chicago first, but eventually they wound up in Washington, D.C., and started this thing called the Sojourners Community, which was in a predominantly Black neighborhood that was targeted for gentrification. So it was one of these borderline things. So a lot of it was face-to-face reconciliation type stuff, Christian witness. Those of you that are worried about the personal piety part, so Wallace is going to make you happy there. And, you know, he's very much likes to build his arguments by quoting biblical proof texts and not appealing to rational readings of the context. Jesus wants him to be there doing reconciliation in Washington, so he did it. I mean, so it's like, it's in the tradition of houses of hospitality and so forth. One of the things that they have done for many years out of the Sojourners community is publish Sojourners magazine. And you can get that as an email feed and read something from Jim Wallace every day if you want to. Subscribe to the magazine. You're supporting something that's very worthy with your money. And Wallace will give you plenty of ideas of things to write your congressman about and rallies to go to and sermons to contemplate about all this kind of stuff. That would be could be a really good takeaway if you want something, any of you here that want something to grab on to. Subscribe to Sojourners Magazine and become part of this extended Sojourners community. It would be a good way to start.
Thank you. Thank you for your question. This has been a really educational time, and it really speaks to one of the facts, one of the things that you both brought up was the need for us to educate ourselves to what is out there. And so with that, I encourage you to continue your education, not just in what you're studying, but in all of these other realms that definitely directly impact our lives in this place and time. Thank you so much for coming.
One other thing. Also, we talked about Sojourners. There's an organization called the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference that's heavily involved in particularly mass incarceration issues. So I know some of you asked about that and were interested in that. It's about how to mobilize more Christians around this issue.
Thank you.
Samuel DeWitt Proctor.
Mm-hmm. Right. It is. Very good.
Tell them you heard about it here at Veritas.
Did that get on the Veritas feed? Were they going to slap us up on the internet?
Well, thank you all for coming. Look out for more Veritas information next semester. Have a good evening.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.